3D printer infill, a topic that's so full of polarized points of view, personal preferences, and passionate presumptions that I thought, well, this is something that I can jump into and surely not get wrapped up in any controversies. Perfect. But on a serious note, there are still plenty of things here that don't have a definitive answer yet. So today I want to test three different aspects to infill. First, what is the best infill pattern? And yes, best almost never has one single answer, so this breaks down into a couple of subsections. I'll be comparing both how fast they print, how strong they are, and how good of a job they do supporting the print's top surface, because yes, sometimes all you care about is your print's looks and not how rigid or strong they are. And I'll be doing this all with the exact same amount of material used for each pattern, not just with the same infill percentage, because turns out you can't trust the infill percentage number at all when changing between patterns. Second, should you be printing your infill with a thicker nozzle? This keeps coming up as an argument for dual extruder or tool changer printers, basically saying you can speed up your prints by just using a fatter nozzle for the infill when you won't be seeing that anyway. But that also makes the infill structure coarser for the same amount of material used. So is it worth the speed gain? And third, more infill or a thicker shell? The engineering logic is that you should always prefer putting more material into the shell of your parts, because that's where the majority of the strain is going to happen. But there has to be a crossover point where there's simply not enough infill to support the shell. So we'll find that point, again, keeping the amount of filament used constant. I'll be printing all of this on the XL. Well, I've already printed all this on the XL because it's the only printer where I can chuck up two different nozzle sizes and use them in the same print for different sections. For filament, I thought about which materials I would actually use when strength matters. PLA is very rigid and strong, but it also likes to creep, and when you really need strength in mechanical applications, you quite often also have at least some amount of heat involved. So while it makes for easy testing, PLA just seemed a bit pointless. The other extreme end of the spectrum with polycarbonates, ABS or ASA, those are also good candidates for mechanical applications. But because I don't have the enclosure set up yet, and even then I don't think it would be very much controlled to consistent temperature, I compromised and I used PETG instead. It's the softest of the materials and it might sometimes bend instead of snapping off, but that's still good data. And what a coincidence! All the PETG I'll be using is from today's sponsor, Voxel PLA. Their PETG Plus and PLA Pro are among the most affordable filament choices you can print with at just $16.99 per spool, or even less with bulk discounts. Voxel filaments are exclusively used in their 150 machine print farm in Southern California, and I only have good things to report about them as well. They print great with default profiles and no tweaking, they're suitable for high flow printing, and have been a perfectly reliable choice for me. Also check out their printer upgrades like the Bento Box Air Filter, Hoola Vibration Damper, and the Python AMS Dryer upgrade at the link below. Let's get started with infill patterns. I'm going to group these into four categories: 2D, 3D, specialty, and dubious. In the basic 2D camp, we've got the old favorites like grid, triangles, stars, and honeycomb. The odd one out here is honeycomb because it's the only one that avoids crossing over itself in one layer and instead creates double width walls in those spots. Crossing over already printed walls can be an issue, especially when you're going fast, because you'll often see the extruded line rip and tear at those points, which can weaken the infill structure as a whole. It's not an issue here, but you know, if you go full speed on some prints, can be a thing. But honeycomb, being a hexagonal pattern, has tons of little corners that the printer has to slow down for. It's a rather slow pattern to print. We'll get to the exact print times in a bit, but as a rough estimate versus something like simple grid, honeycomb takes about 20% longer to print. And that difference only goes up the faster your maximum print speeds are. Then the 3D group, the cool kids of the bunch: cubic and its variety, 3D honeycomb, and gyroid. 3D honeycomb and gyroid are non-crossing patterns again, but again, they are on the slower side. The gyroid pattern is explicitly meant to have even strength in all directions, and it is a very organic pattern, while 3D honeycomb is more of a octagonal pattern that changes print direction every layer. Cubic is actually just cubes stacked on their corners, hence the name. So it looks a lot fancier in the slicer than it actually is. Actually, it is just the regular grid infill tilted and, you know, printed with a solid layer every now and then. I do like the 3D patterns because they evolve as the print moves up. So I feel like they do a better job to consistently support the top layer of your print and also tying together surfaces that may not ever get touched by a classic constant 2D pattern. Then specialty. These are circumstantially useful, and that's lightning infill, which I can't print without a shell to show you, and that is designed to use as little material as possible while still holding up the top surface. And then support cubic, which does the same thing, but with the cubic pattern that prints tighter and tighter cubes the closer you get to that top surface. Neither one of these is designed for strength, but just to give you good-looking parts with as little material as possible. I've printed some samples with lightning infill anyway, but that's mostly for completeness because, you know, the strength of lightning infill literally depends on which way you hold it. And then the dubious patterns. I mean, I see why they are in the slicer, and that's because they are, by their mathematical definition, patterns that fill in a surface with an adjustable amount of fill density. Yay. These all happen to be non-crossing patterns as well. But honestly, I don't think these will provide any value at all. But hey, I'm very open to be convinced otherwise. The most striking one certainly is the Hilbert curve. It's more of a mathematical phenomenon than an actually mechanically sound concept, but I have to admit, it does look cool. I would also put concentric, the Archimedean chords, and octagon spiral in that camp. Rectangular looks similar to grid, only that each layer is exclusively printed in one direction and it alternates every layer. So this is a pattern that only has point contact between the layers and uses most of its material in unsupported bridges. Aligned rectilinear is the same pattern, just with all the layers aligned in the same direction. Makes sense, you know. And lastly, the line infill pattern. It's the same pattern again as rectilinear, but this time drunk. I still printed all of the patterns as test parts. My intuition would be that the effect of the different infill patterns would be more pronounced the more space it has to work with. But printing samples large enough that especially the 3D patterns would have enough space to not just turn into a single mush layer would mean I'd have samples that would end up breaking me instead of me breaking them. So I simply scaled everything down and used a 0.25mm nozzle for these parts. The parts all printed perfectly with the smaller nozzle. So all I'm doing is scaling down the strength of all these parts evenly. This, of course, also saved me a bunch of filament and print time. Speaking of time, here's how the patterns stacked up for print times. Basically, there is a fast group and a slow group, but within each group, you're probably not going to notice a dramatic difference in print times. But when going from a fast pattern to a slow one, print times increased on average by a third, and that is with the same amount of material laid down in each of these prints. As expected, patterns that use many short moves instead of longer continuous ones do take longer to print as well, with the fastest one actually being concentric, which does use one single continuous line, making it very hard to beat. The default grid pattern is tied for second place, with the three rectangular varieties that also just print straight lines, followed by stars, cubic, and triangles. The slowest pattern overall is lightning, but it's an odd one out, because A, I couldn't get it to lay down as much material so that it would use the same amount as the others, and B, it's not even meant to be used at such high infill ratios anyways. All it does is make the very top structure denser, which at a certain point doesn't end up being material that is useful at all in the print. Over in the slow group, gyroid is actually the fastest pattern. And while it didn't make much difference for print times back when the pattern was first introduced, before input shaping had become a thing, with printers now moving much faster, it means they have to slow down to accurately print the swirly goodness that is gyroid. But maybe it makes up for it with its strength. Well, sort of. It takes third place. Second place is actually the fastest printing pattern, concentric, though take this with a grain of salt, because concentric doesn't have a consistent pattern throughout, and I think really we just got lucky here and managed to get a spot that was perfectly oriented for the bend loads that I was applying. Most of the other patterns form a surprisingly tight middle group, with the only outliers being lightning, again, not made for strength, and Hilbert curve, which, you know, falls into that same camp as concentric, Archimedean chords, octagram spiral of not being a consistent pattern, which I think automatically disqualifies all of them from being used for structural parts. And if you're counting cards, you'll know what the top spot is. It's cubic, with a significant lead actually. Now, caveats. I tested these patterns printed flat and on their side, but not in any other orientation. So not like that, not like this, not any other way. So some patterns might behave differently, even in slightly changed alignments. And I only tested for bend loads, as it's the easiest one for me to test, but also most real life loads, even if they're just forces and not torque like that, they do end up inducing a bend load of at least some amount of significance. Also, while these results are consistent for this geometry, with this combination of print profile, printer, and material, things might change slightly, significantly, as you go to different part geometries with a different filament that's more or less rigid, or has a higher or lower material strength. But I think the general trends should still transfer. We're going to dive a bit deeper into strength in a bit, but first let's look at top solid layer support. The test prints for these were done with only 3 top solid layers and roughly 10% infill. Again, I had to adjust each pattern individually to make sure they all use the same amount of material and don't just say the same infill percentage. And all of these prints look about the same. They all have some areas where they covered well, other bits where they didn't do so well, except for aligned rectilinear. This one is almost perfect, and it makes total sense. All the other patterns have sections where that first solid layer has to span a distance that's too large to bridge over cleanly. But because aligned rectilinear is, well, aligned, it ends up being perfectly at that 90 degree angle, which gives that first solid layer the perfect geometry to bridge over. Even lightning isn't this good. This one's lightning, and yet there's an area that's not covering well. One interesting thing here is that between the regular cubic and the support cubic print, the support cubic one does print a coarser structure down low, as it should, but because it then wastes material on printing double walls as it transitions to the full density pattern, if you actually give it the same total amount of material to use, it has the exact same density of pattern where it gets to that top, where it has to support the top solid layers. With larger prints, there is an actual benefit to using support cubic, but keep in mind that also if you give the support and adaptive cubic patterns the same infill percentage without even doing anything adaptive, they will by default create a coarser structure and use less material than standard cubic. I know I'm talking a lot about cubic here, because that's the pattern that I think so far comes out as the overall winner. It's very strong, it prints reasonably quickly, and it doesn't show issues with its ability to support material printed on top of it as the top solid layers. So it's the pattern I'm moving forward with for the next test, and that is figuring out whether you can just print your infill thicker. That's these parts. Now, these prints were all done on the XL, because there I can mix and match nozzle sizes. But as good as these parts look, the alignment issues on my XL struck once again, and while one side is done perfectly and has bonded very well between the shell done on one nozzle and the infill done on another, the other side is just completely loose. Like I can just rip this off. There's zero bondage happening there. This isn't good for strength, obviously. Maybe I'll come back in the future and explore this option of using different tool heads, different nozzles more. But for this video, I had to compromise and just print everything with one nozzle and different extrusion widths, which worked really well too, but it's not the cool two color look that I was going for. The results with what I tested here though are promising, and there doesn't seem to be any significant loss in strength with printing the infill wider and faster. But again, this was fairly limited testing and more exploration is required here. And lastly, and this was actually the biggest chunk of printing and prep work, where should you put your material? Into the infill or into the perimeter? I need to explain my methodology here real quick. I wanted to test 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 perimeters. So I started with a 30% infill part for each one. I then looked at the weight of each of those samples and for each series, adjusted the infill percentage for all the other perimeter counts until I had a set of parts that all used the same amount of filament, just distributed differently. And of course, I did that for all the other starting points as well. I also used 5 perimeters and 50% infill as a high fill starting point and a single 100% print. By the way, when I say perimeters, I actually mean shell thickness. I did increase the top and bottom minimum thickness to be identical to the actual perimeters. And the results here ended up being quite interesting or boring, depending on which way you look at it. There was not a single instance where more infill ended up being the better choice over a thicker shell. This is the result that one should expect, but I definitely thought that we would be running into issues with things like wall buckling with lower infills, which would reduce strength, but it looks like those might only start becoming an issue once you go into the extremes with almost no infill and very thin shells as well. But since I'm testing for strength, I wanted to use settings that you typically use for functional parts. So those sort of featherweight prints aren't included here, but they might still hold some interesting data. Now, while these trends would suggest that the best settings to use for strength would be as thick of a shell as you can get and zero infill, I wouldn't say that that's universally true. Again, it's true for this one part shape, material printer combo, but I can easily think of a bunch of shapes that would profit from at least some amount of infill. Let's say you have a large flat part that would not just be unprintable without infill, it would also be pretty bad at supporting any amount of weight. Or something that has like a corrugated or baffle shaped outer wall, even just a small amount of infill would help with the strength and rigidity of that part much more than extra shells. So with typical prints, which are most often compact parts with walls that are a couple millimeters thick, your material will still be best used in the shell and not the infill. I guess as a rule of thumb, I'd say use just enough infill, 15-20%, you know, something like this, something that is the default in most slices. That's going to allow your part to print cleanly and then put whatever material you want to use on top of that to increase the shell thickness. Even in high infill situations, where the part just requires it, probably you're not going to need to go above 30% for most parts. And for patterns, honestly, I think your and your slice's default should be cubic. Maybe even adaptive cubic, because that will conveniently save some material with really chunky parts, while behaving mostly like regular cubic otherwise, as long as you account for the difference in fill density at the same percentage. And if you don't care about strength much and just want clean, fast prints, maybe even give aligned rectilinear a try. Just don't forget to add some solid layers every now and then to stabilize the infill pattern. Let me know what your experiences have been with this sort of stuff and when printing structural parts. Do you have a favorite infill pattern? I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. As always, I hope you learned something. Thank you for watching. Keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.